Morning. Hey, let's try that again. Good morning. All right. I know you got to get reacquainted with each other and remember each other's names and all that kind of thing when you first come in, but it's good to be a part of you. Good to have our friends on the internet joining us also. That crowd's getting a little bigger all the time. And it's almost getting to be Christmas time. Does that scare you? Yeah. I haven't even started my Christmas shopping, and it only amounts to one or two people, so don't get too excited about that. But I want you to know that we are glad that you're here. It's a great day to be in the house of the Lord, and we're wondering how things are going to work out. We want you to know that on Christmas, on the Sunday before Christmas, we're going to be trying to cover this whole altar in poinsettias. And in your bulletin, there is a slip saying that you would like to purchase one of those that will be delivered to the church and put up here, and then you can take it home after Christmas Eve when we have our Christmas Eve services on the Monday, the 23rd. Sorry about that. But anyway, if that's a possibility, then we can do that. Also, we're going to be serving lunch on Christmas Day. And if you don't have a place already, I don't know what Pastor John's doing up here. He's kind of taking...
He is
looking around.
Everybody's here.
I was making announcements.
Oh, well, you know, I was up here and I just realized how gorgeous the decorations are here this morning.
Well, they are nice, yeah.
Wow.
They're good.
I mean, look at this.
All the way across the arch.
Yeah.
And the wreaths, and they decorated you.
Yeah, how about that? Did this just happen all by itself?
No. There are lots of people that were down here yesterday working.
Oh, we've got Christmas angels, do we?
Those Christmas angels were down here. Their little elves were all over the place. They were in Smoot Hall, and they were over here, and they were in the chapel.
They must have been. They were everywhere.
They were very excited.
I saw Smoot Hall.
Yes.
Amazing.
Are you excited about Christmas now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That'll do it.
Well, the people are amazing, too.
Yeah. I bet there's some of them are here that helped yesterday.
You suppose some of those Christmas angels might be here
today? If you helped decorate yesterday, raise your hand so we can know which kind of hands helped to decorate.
Don't be bashful.
I guess they were all in the 9 o'clock
service. They must have been, yeah. Well, there's an opportunity to help at the end of Christmas there.
That's it.
Isn't this great? Aren't we blessed to have folks who would come in and decorate and help us prepare for Christmas?
That's it.
I'll get out of your way now and let you do.
Thank you for
what
your
you
help.
Do. Well,
you look good in a cap. Okay, and we also have the Christmas luncheon on Christmas Day. I was going to tell you about, and you need to buy your ticket. You don't just show up on that day and buy a ticket. We have to know how many to prepare for. And so those tickets are on sale between services if you come a little early next Sunday, or you can buy them at the church office during the week. So that way you don't have to shop and cook for all those supplies. You don't have to do the dishes. You just come and have a great time with a lot of fun people and sing some Christmas carols and have a nice way of celebrating Christmas on Christmas Day. One of our choir members, Landon Grody, is going to be the cook that day. So we want to thank him for being willing to make that sacrifice and cook for all of us on Christmas Day. And some of us will be here to help serve and do all those kinds of things. We also want you to notice that in the bulletin there is a number of announcements of Bible studies and all kinds of activities that are going on in that way. And so as we do that, we want you to know that you can participate in any of the activities that you see, from the exercise classes to the Bible studies to the other trips and things that are going on that our Methodist travelers are planning. So we hope that you'll be a part of as many things as possible. And I need to find out real quickly if there's anybody sitting to the right of the center that is here for the very first time. If there's anybody that's never been here before, would you lift your hands and let me come to you? Okay. If you'll pass that microphone down, we can get her name. Tell us your name and where you're from.
My name's Sharon.
Washington State. All right. Good to hear. It's a little warmer here. Sometimes. It's a little chilly this morning. You're past this pen over there. That's a gift from us to you for take the cap off and push the button that lights up because we're the light of the world, after all. Then I saw another hand over here. Zip around here. Okay. Hi there. Both of you? Most? Okay. Okay. What's your name? Hold
my
it close.
Name's Sue, and I'm from Iowa.
Sue from Iowa. We've got tons of people from Iowa. We're so thankful that Iowa must be a wonderful place. All right. Good to have you, Sue. I'm going to give you one of our pins also. All right. And I saw somebody else. Okay, over here on the end. People are pointing at you. Santa Clarita, California. All right, Andrew. That's one of my son's names. God bless you. Good to have you with us. Okay. Good to have these visitors coming to see us. If you're sitting on the left side and you're here for the first time, would you lift your hand? Find out your name. Okay, wonderful. What is your name?
My name's Diane.
Diane, originally from?
Well, I live in Texas.
In Texas? Okay, well, I grew up in Oklahoma and went to Texas for a while to get my education, so we'll give you one of those. God bless you. All right. And we have a renewal cross for which we pray for people. We've been praying for Carol McLaughlin this last week, and Carol has someone that she wants to give the renewal cross to for the coming week.
I want to give the renewal cross to Marilyn and Frank Butcher, and I thank you all for your prayers.
Okay, she's had a good time with the prayers, and Marilyn Butcher is going to be Marilyn Butcher is going to be the one that'll be holding the cross this next week, so we want to keep her in mind and in our prayers. All right. Let's continue with our worship time now.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. I invite you to stand so we can call each other to worship. To you, O Lord, we lift our hearts. Your mercy and your love have stood throughout the ages. Let our worship of God begin.
You may be seated. This is the first Sunday of Advent, and so we're going to celebrate the lighting of the very first candle.
The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests on his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Isaiah 9, verse 2 and 6. Today, we remember the prophets of old who demanded to be heard, who dared to speak of a child to come, unexpected liberator of the people, vulnerable incarceration of the holiest of holies, a new name for God. Hey, we give thanks for the prophets among us who brings us surprise, new visions, who challenge us to think outside the box, who show us a future we never anticipated. On this first Sunday of Advent, we light, I think I'm supposed to say this as I light it. Okay, on this first Sunday of Advent, we light this candle for the prophets who renew our faith and remind us of what may be.
Let us join now in affirming our faith in God and our faith in Christ and our hope in the Holy Spirit. The Lord is holy and awesome and full of power. He sent his Son to earth to redeem mankind. Jesus came and lived among us, dying that we might live. He returned to heaven, promising to return again one day. He will come in righteousness and holiness, bring peace to all people. The Spirit of God lives with us now, moving and breathing life into our souls. We wait expectantly for our King, our ruler, our Savior. He is coming. This we believe.
As we come to this very precious time of praying together, the Bible tells us when two or three are agreed upon anything, that God will act upon that prayer and will give us His answer. We also know that God never ignores the prayers of His people. So let me ask you, if you would please, to take the insert out of your bulletin, turn it over to the back page, and you'll see two columns of people that have been placed there. Many of them are new this week because of certain situations and conditions in their lives. They've asked for prayer. With their permission, they are on that list. We'd ask you that you take this with you today and use it as a prayer guide through the week. Pray for these by name. You'll notice that the families of those who have lost loved ones, the Frank Hotel, Anita Marcy, passed away this last week, and also Tom Whiston, Casey Rice. On the inside of that same page, you'll notice those that are listed in the hospital. We think that maybe one or two of those has been able to go home. Ken Beer is expected to go home by Saturday. Also in the hospital, we just found out this morning, Linda Craycraft had very extensive back surgery this last week and is now back in the emergency room with severe pain in her hip and leg. Also, Carolyn Vance was diagnosed with pneumonia this weekend and has gone to Boswell Hospital and is being treated there. So you'll notice the times and the dates of those having memorial services, and we hope that those of you who knew them or feel led would come and take part in the celebration of their lives. Also, our homebound member this week that we want you to write cards to is John and Arliss Ferris. They're both in assisted living in the care center there at Freedom Plaza Care Center, and would like for you to be able to stay in touch with them. Their apartment number and street number and everything is there for you to be able to contact them. In a moment, we're going to be having a song of prayer introduction, and we'd like for you to take this time, beginning now, to voice your personal concerns and prayers to the Lord that will continue for just a few moments following the prayer song. Dear Lord of heaven and earth, we thank you that you are here with us today to But your Holy Spirit is around us and within us and guiding us, Lord. We thank you that you give us wonderful patience, that you accept us even after we have made mistakes and gone against your will in our lives. We confess these things before you, Lord, that we live selfishly as our society dictates in many ways. And yet still, Lord, we desire to become more like Jesus, that we become more in shape with the function for which you have created us. We thank you, Father, for the way that you have guided us this far in our lives and the provisions that you have made and the blessings that we experience. How many gifts, Lord, do we count each day of what you have provided for us to enjoy and that you have provided to sustain us, encourage us, love us, and bring us into your very presence. We thank you for the gift of Jesus Christ, who came as a little baby, the Messiah already, all man and all God. Thank you, Lord, that he lived in a way that showed us how we can live victoriously over anything this world has to throw at us, and even in death, Lord, to create victory. As he rose again, and as he promised to come back again, Lord, help us to live in a way that would demonstrate your love to everyone that we come in contact with. And as Jesus taught us, Lord, we also pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our Lord. Heads, because your redemption is drawing near. The word of God for the people of God.
It's really great. I know I can see you better sitting there. I've been standing for a couple hours. I've decided that you all would want me to sit just as you do, right? Okay. Well, let's have a moment of prayer. Oh, loving God, we come together today to hear your word, to express it in so many different ways. And we thank you, Lord, for that and just ask that it be spoken and sung and remembered in the way you would have us hear it. And that as we hear it, that it becomes alive for us and has meaning, not just for the moment, but for every single moment of our lives as we grow closer and ever nearer to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I had a strange experience where I was talking with people about what Advent was about. And I explained that Advent was the combination of two words from Roman Latin, ad venio, and it meant simply to come, coming, or arrival. And then I went on to explain that it was about God's promises to us. So let me just ask you and let you think about it. What does Advent mean to you? A couple of friends said they thought it was preparation for the celebration of Christmas. And that's not entirely wrong. Everything in the church year is a preparation for us and gives credit to God for the birth of the Christ child. A person who came to us and walked among us, who could help us learn through his words and his example and his expansion on the word of God as it was known at that time, expanding it so that we understood it better, maybe more clearly and more in context with human life. But Advent is about something else too. It's about Christ is coming. And so the title of this message today is Rejoice, Christ is Coming. Christ has come at the manger. Christ will come again at the second coming. That's what Advent is about. It's about two promises that God has made. For years through the prophets of old in the Old Testament, we see words about how a Messiah is coming in. It's going to liberate people and spread justice and righteousness across the earth, starting with the children of Israel, and then, of course, it spread to the rest of the world. And in that spreading of the word of God through the Christ child, we learn more about what God has in store for us because we are Easter people. And we are somewhat like the disciples in the passage today that was read. There's more to the passage, and it's quite a long passage, so I printed it out in big font. It's always nice to be able to read something in big font because the lights are not that bright here. But after the coming of the Son of Man that you all heard in a minute ago, there is a lesson of the fig tree about, well, of course you'll know when that's happening. A cataclysmic remake of the cosmos and Christ descending from the heavens, remaking the earth. That'd be kind of, Christ says, like a fig tree that begins to bloom and you know that summer's around the corner. When you see the heavens remade and the earth changes, then you know that Christ is on his way. You know that he is coming to us, that there is a judgment day, a coming before the Lord, an accounting for our lives and a redemption. But it goes on with these verses, 34 through 36. These are Jesus' words as he speaks to his disciples in Jerusalem before his crucifixion. Be on guard so that your hearts are not weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness, and the worries of this life and that day does not catch you unexpectedly like a trap. For it will come upon all who live on the face of the whole earth, that is the changes in the heavens and the descending of Christ. Be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all these things that will take place and to stand before the Son of Man. Advent is about preparing our hearts for a time of celebration, giving thanks for the birth of the Christ child, but it is also a time of preparing ourselves in mind and body and spirit that we might hear God's word more carefully and closely and allow it to fill us and allow it to come alive today and every day so that we grow closer to God. When Christ spoke these words to his disciples, he was also telling them that he would give them words, and by his example, they would know how to handle things when he was gone. Don't you remember at the Transfiguration on, he was telling people that he would not be with them always, but that he would be leaving, but then he would come again. He's telling them again. They must have been in a state of denial coming into Jerusalem on what we call Palm Sunday because they still thought he was going to be a king, right? That they would sit in his court. And now he's telling them again as they wander the streets of Jerusalem and he's preaching and teaching, he's telling them that he won't be there and that they will have days of hardship as well as of joy in spreading his word and his example to others. They're not sure how to handle that. And he points out to them and to us that there is no time set aside because they want to find out the answer to their questions. When is this going to happen? Well, you and I know that it took centuries, thousands of years of human existence before the Messiah was born. And so whether it was the next day or thousands of years more, he's not able to tell us and he's not able to tell them. But then they say, well, wait a minute, if you're not going to be around and we can't just follow you around, then what can we do? What do we do? What's going to happen to us? And he said, you're just going to go spread this word. And they did. And we have those words and their example today because they did that faithfully, regardless of the hardship and the difficulties that they encountered in their lives. There are people today still trying to predict when that time will be. And there have been a lot of stories about it, some quite serious, and some of them really pretty funny. I didn't share with the other two services, so this is just for you guys. A very funny story told by humorist, I didn't tell it the other one, now I've forgotten, Louis Grizzard. He told about a character he made up, Luther Gilroy. Luther Gilroy apparently got this idea that the second coming was at hand, and so he sold everything and went to sit on the roof of his barn so he'd be closer to being lifted up. His wife came out and saw him sitting on the roof of the barn. She noticed he'd been missing. Luther, she said, what are you doing up there? He said, I saw a sign down at the crossroads. The end is near and I'm ready for it. You know, she'd been married to Luther a long time. She just said, oh, for heaven's sake. She went in and called the deputy sheriff. She said, would you come do something about Luther? So he came over and Luther, he said, what was it? That sign at the crossroads, you know, the one that says the end is near? Well, the deputy sheriff says, you know that sign doesn't say that, don't you, Luther? What it says is go drink a beer. Luther obviously needed glasses. Well, we probably need glasses too, to read the Word of God more closely and to share it with others, to have the opportunity to let it live in our hearts. We also want to know what we can do. And it's kind of like children with a Christmas tree and presents underneath. We want to open them. And yet you and I know that even for children of any age or stage in life, you and me included, Not every gift we receive is one that is joyful. Some of those are very difficult, and we need to learn how to deal with them. And one of the ways we can deal with them is to remember that when our world falls apart, our hope remains with God and God's presence in our lives. That happened to me when I was just almost 50 years old. My life fell apart. I wasn't going to have any of the family or any of the resources or any of the life that I thought was going to follow that time. And so my hope rested on God. And I prayed repeatedly that God would let me know what I was to do and guide me to people who would be able to explain it to me. And one day God did talk with me in my mind's ear and reminded me that I've been called to ordained ministry 22 years earlier. I've been very busy with a newborn baby and two young sons. I just didn't see that God was probably talking to me, and I said, that must be somebody next door or way down in another block. I think God's gotten lost. Well, God wasn't lost, but it's one of those things that sometimes is difficult to catch on to. I love church. I love God's people. I love the Word of God. I love discovering more and more about how to live out God's Word. And I'll bet you do too. That's why we're all here today, correct? Right? Right. But I put my hope in God, and I'm glad I did. Some other people have done the same thing in terms of long-term life projects. One of those that I've enjoyed reading about is Bruce Olson in 1962. He decided that he had heard about a Stone Age tribe of people in Venezuela. Deep in the jungle, nobody had been able to take the word of God in Christ Jesus to them. And he felt as a missionary, he should do that. He just knew that now that he knew about them, that's what God was calling him to do. So he didn't know the language in Venezuela, but it didn't matter. If God called him to do that, he needed to go and do it. So he did. He went to Venezuela, and he explained to people why he was there. And some of them said they'd help him get in to see the Motolone people, that tribe of people were so isolated, but they knew how to find them. So they took him into the jungle, and he spent 7 days with everyone, cutting their way through vines and undergrowth and the huge trees that were there, and they still hadn't reached the tribe when an arrow pierced his leg. It created an infection, and he had amoebic dysentery and was bleeding badly, and so they took him back to a hospital in Maracaibo. I think maybe I should stand up. I do better. I don't forget things standing up. Maracaibo in Venezuela. And the hospital took care of him, and they said, you know, it'll be 6 months. Can you imagine an infection like that was going to take 6 months before they could cure him? And he said, but I have to get back to that tribe. I never got there. I never shared the word of God through Jesus Christ with them. And they said, you're never going there. You're never going to be strong enough. The man really believed he was called to do that. He understood that God was prompting him, and he wanted to respond. And so he walked out of the hospital 3 weeks later, not 6 months, but 3 weeks later. He wanted to be there with those people, and he felt so uplifted by God's word that he learned that when God is with us, we can carry on even in the worst of times. And he made his way to that tribe. And he has since written a lot of articles and books about his life with them and spoken to audiences worldwide. His experiences set a tone for the rest of us, that the love of God and the word of God alive in us can propel us to do amazing things if we allow that to happen. You and I do that unwittingly and perhaps unknowingly over and over again. We do small acts of faithfulness and kindness, reflecting God's love and hope in our lives as we reach out to this person or that person. Here we are, the body of Christ, a part of the whole loaf, pieces of God's body around the world, and we give thanks for that. We can extend what we have to each other, but also we recognize that we are one with Christ in this church, and we are one with each other, and we're called to spread the love and hope of God to everyone through Christ Jesus, just as Bruce did. Pretty awesome, huh? To think that we can do that, and that we do, in some ways that are not so obvious. Maybe bringing clothes or luggage for people who need them on the street. Maybe serving meals to people in a center where they're housing women who need a leg up or some help in getting their lives together and finding a way to get ahead and finding a way to support themselves. Maybe by the food share. Did you see the food share barrels out here? They are just full to overflowing. It's a gracious, wonderful gift that you all are giving when you bring that food for the food bank to use. Good for you. Your generosity should be legendary. John will mention it a little bit later in his remarks around the offering. What a wonderful thing that we find that a friendly smile or a handshake or just a hello, how are you, goes a very long way with someone who's feeling lost and alone and perhaps suffering from a diagnosis for something that is threatening. I read a story not that long ago about a woman. Her name is Martha. I'm going to have to stand up to preach. I can't remember anything. Laura Dudley. Laura Dudley is a florist in Bricks Florist in St. Louis, Missouri. And Laura got a telephone call one day from a woman who wanted a wonderful, wonderful gift for her nephew. Her nephew was in a hospital. He was 15 years old. His name was Douglas. She wanted to have the flowers delivered, a plant with live flowers in it, so he'd have some color and uplift for his room. And she told that to Laura. She said, you know, my nephew's been diagnosed with a leukemia that's really moved along. It's a later stage leukemia, and he's really dejected, and he's not allowing his parents to help him, and he's not allowing himself to participate with his doctors because he just shut up with the fear that he has over the diagnosis. And so Laura said, I'll take care of it. And she put together the plant and the live flowers, and she put a note in it from his aunt saying they were for him and they were to lift his spirits because she wanted to send love and hope to him in a difficult time. Laura wrote a note of her own and put it in with the flowers. Dear Douglas, she wrote, you know, when I was about your age, I was diagnosed in a hospital with late stage leukemia, and I was stricken. And I was very troubled. I imagine you are too. I just want you to know that I now am well and that I'm sending these flowers from your aunt, but along with that, I'm sending prayers for you. Prayers that I have in my heart for you that you may have a healing of the sort God wants you to have. And be present to the love and hope that God alone provides and that peace that can fill your heart as it fills mine. Best wishes and prayers from Laura Dudley. What a wonderful happenstance. Was it a happenstance? I doubt that very much. God chooses and uses us in God's own ways to do God's work, and we should be grateful for that. I know you are, I am. If we are careful, we can take what we have, learn more about it, and allow the Word of God to be alive in us, the Word of God to live in us, so that when we say words like Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again, that it fills our hearts with hope, and it fills our hearts with a love for God and for each other, just as Christ wants us to be filled with that love and that hope. How do we get that? We get that by sharing, by witnessing, as the disciples did. We get that by being members of this church and sharing our witness with others. In a book, Traveling Mercies, Annie Lamont writes about a little girl that was lost who tried to take a little different route home for school and got lost, and so she couldn't find how to get on the right path. We meet people like that sometimes, don't we? We need to help them. We need to share with them. Anyway, a police officer came along in his squad car and said, "Hi there, you shouldn't be out at this time of late afternoon. I'll bet your parents are worried. Could I take you someplace?" She said, "I don't know where I live. I don't know how to get there." And he said, "Well, what about you climb in my car and I'll drive around until we see something that's a landmark, you know, and maybe then we can get you home to your parents and I'll make sure I explain to them what happened." She said, "Okay." And they started driving around here and there. And finally she said, "Wait a minute, wait, stop. Look, I know what that is." It was a spire on a church. "That's my church. You know, officer, I know my way home from church. That's where I find God. I'm at home with God there, and I can get to my house from there." May we be like that child. May the word of God come alive in us so God can lead us home. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Linda, for that good, powerful message. We need to hear that Jesus is coming again. Amen? And as he comes again, we are to be about the business of sharing the good news and the love of Christ wherever we go. One way we celebrate this love that ties us together is through the great observance of communion, the Lord's Supper. And as we do so, we introduce that by reading a reading called the Great Thanksgiving. So if you'll join with me, let's share this together. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, 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 Lord God of heaven and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
On that night when Jesus broke bread, he was with his best friends as we are gathered here today. He took the bread and he asked for God's blessing. "Take this bread I break for you, and as I do, remember this bread is my body broken for you. Take it, eat it, each time you do, remember me, remember me. Take this cup I've poured for you, and as you do, remember me. This cup is my covenant I'm making with you. Take it, drink it, each time you do, remember me. Remember me. Take this love, I give it to you, and as you do, remember me. And so, Holy God, we give thanks for these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ. Lord, that we, your people, might be renewed and refreshed and ready to go into the world with the hope that is found in you and the love of Jesus Christ, in the redemption of our sins and in new life, and the hope that you are coming again. And so we give thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll invite the ushers to come. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Eat this and remember all that he has done for you. The new covenant in Christ was given through his life, through his blood. This covenant of grace, this cup of grace which you hold, is Christ's gift to us. This cup of grace never runs empty because Christ always invites us back, always has more. His cup never runs dry. So drink and be grateful for all Christ has done for you.
As we contemplate on what Christ has done for us, we also come to a time of giving, which is a great time, especially during the Christmas season, to consider the gifts that we give back to the Lord. So as the ushers come forward to receive God's tithes and God's offerings, would you allow yourself to give generously as God leads you? Thank you.
and you are a generous people. I'm thankful today for those who were here Thursday night for the Music Serving the Word concert as a benefit for an orphanage in Belarus that is part of their ministry. We had about 250 people here in attendance at that concert, and the music was wonderful. And I want to share with you, after, out of the 250, I think we had about 50 to 75 guests, but they raised over $1,300 for that orphanage in Belarus that will go directly to them. It's significant, and so I give thanks and praise for that. Yes. Let us give thanks now for what God has provided for His ministry here. Lord Jesus, we do give thanks for these gifts. I know that they represent sacrifice and hard work and toil, and honor that. We give thanks for it. We bless it in the name of Jesus, Lord, that we would be good stewards, that you would guide us, and Lord, that you would multiply these gifts beyond our imaginations. And so we thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. And now let us share together in singing, "Come, thou long-expected Jesus, may he come again and come swiftly."
Brothers and sisters, how grateful we all are, aren't we, to be able to be here in the house of the Lord with each other at Lakeview. What a blessing to receive the love of God and the hope for a new tomorrow and an opportunity to share that love and hope with others. So go in love in Jesus' name and spread that love to all the world. Amen.